You guys are all really successful in your industry, but in your opinion, like, let's start with the success question. What do you feel like is the biggest contributing factor to your success?
Repetition, hands down. Nope, hands down, repetition since I was a kid. I told myself, there's no way in the world am I gonna go through my life and not do what I wanna do. And I'm not joking when I tell you, I've said that 100 times a day ever since I was a little kid. I grew up in Detroit, which is primarily a blue collar town, so there's a lot of guys that are working factory gigs. And I just said, I understand the stability that that provides for their family, but for me, I'm a wild horse. And to be caged like that, I would be absolutely miserable before I was 50. And I said, there's no way am I gonna live my life that way. It has to be on my terms. And so, for good, bad, or otherwise, every decision I made was referenced up against, okay, my life goal is to do what I want my way. Does this allow me to do that? And I would turn down opportunities that I knew, this is gonna cage me, this isn't gonna allow me to move forward. And so that was it. For me, it was just always, I'm gonna do this, period, and I will not accept no for an answer.
So saying no, sometimes, to things that were not, that took you away from the path that you felt like you were focused on walking.
Yeah, I mean, in general, I'm a pretty workable guy. I'm pretty easy to get along with. I have no problem conceding and making things work out with everything in my life except for that one thing. That's the one thing where it's like, nope, this is my one opportunity to be stubborn and selfish. This is the only thing I'm asking out of the world is let me do this thing. Beyond that, I'll work with anybody and anything else. But that's the one thing where it's like, nope, this is my one get out of jail free card. I get to be stubborn and selfish about this because it's my life.
Well, I think, that sort of singular focus on something and deciding that early on in your life, I think like that, if you talk to people who are very successful in what they do, that's like a reoccurring theme, right? Mm-hmm. I kind of know I wanted to do this. I've always been into making movies, making music, whatever it is, right? And you've been focused on that and it's something that's driven you through your career. I think that's probably true of everyone at this table, right? Mm-hmm. That you kind of know, I've always liked doing this and I want to find a way to do this all the time. And I think it's funny because like a lot of people say, I think it's very intimidating when you come into school environment, whatever, that they say, well, you know, focus on your passion, you know, like, focus on that passion. And I think that what people misunderstand is that it's, I know exactly what I'm going to do in 15 years, and I have a set of steps that I will need to follow to do that. And it just isn't that. The passion isn't a specific thing. It isn't working on a specific show or doing a specific job. I think it's a feeling. I think it's a sense that you are achieving what for you is your passion. And there's 100 ways to do that. And you have to try a bunch of stuff to get there. Mm-hmm. But I think that, you know, you sort of have this internal, you know, sort of GPS that's sending you towards that thing that ultimately you tend to do the thing that you feel the most rewarded by, I think so.
Right. And the key thing is to, all of us will probably agree, is to, like Rick said, you set it up so that it's based on how hard you work and how hard you drive. And then that way you determine your success and you make it hinge upon yourself and no outside factors. Nobody can come fire you. Nobody can tell you, hey, you need to work this hard and da da da. You set it up so where the result is based on what you put into it.
I tell people, try to find a niche to exploit. I got into the business, I had a background in electronics. So I always knew I wanted to get into film, but you know, if you've ever looked at starting in the camera department, it is a long, long climb. You make coffee for 3 years and then you become a loader. But I found this little niche off in visual effects, robotic cameras, motion control, where electronics is really in demand. And I was able to climb that path and I was DPing miniatures units in about 3 years, whereas most of the people I know who just attacked it frontally were still making coffee.
Yeah.
So and you know, everybody has a niche. I tell the story a couple of years ago. I got a call from a Full Sail graduate, and he's looking for advice. He's in New York. He's trying to break into MTV and VH1, and we're talking, and he says it's been tough for me. I've been in New York. I've been hitting it, but this was back when we were going to war in Iraq, and but I can't get my head around it because I've got family back in Iran and Iraq, and I'm like, wait, where do you have family? And he's telling me his stories from Iraq or Iran. How many languages do you speak? Well, I speak Farsi and I speak Arabic, and I'm like, no, dude, walk across the street to NBC and CBS and ABC, walk into the newsroom and tell them you can speak Farsi. And that's what he did. And he called me back 3 days later and he said, I got a job. And he had just overlooked the obvious, you know, his little skill.
Yeah, I think a lot of kids, they think sort of linear, and they think, like you said, the steps. And I think we could all probably say the same thing. We all sort of, you know, if that's the one thing that I could impart is that they're, like you said, find a niche. Like, I realized what I was good at early on, and it wasn't the thing that I came here to go to school for, you know, but that was okay. It was like, I'm really, really good at this, and it's okay that even though I started out wanting to do this, that there are alternatives, and I ultimately got where I wanted to go, and I took this long, crazy, you know, exciting path to get there, and that's important to know.
Yeah, I think a big part of success is really realizing that a realistic path isn't always the most glamorous, but also being open to opportunities that you might not have thought of, and really honing your intuition to recognize those opportunities when they come along, because something really good might pass you by. Mm-hmm. So keeping an open mind is maybe what I'm hearing from you.
No,
guys.
Definitely. Like, and then sometimes you have to step back to go forward, and then I think a lot of people don't realize they look at it like, you know, as going backwards, and you just have to look at the big picture and just know and have faith in your ability and you know, turn down things when it's not right for you and take the things that might be so you're not so sure, but you just have to be open to all of those things.
A lot of times you don't even control that, right? You get laid off or get fired, but you don't let that ever get you down, right? I mean, one example that I like telling students is like, you know, I got laid off at Microsoft. That was my dream job, to be an employee there, you know, 2 years working in games. And then 9 a.m. they said, you're laid off. I'm like, all right. So I turned around, launched my Kickstarter an hour after. And then from there, because of that, I was working in VR. So it's like a door closes and then your windows and 10,000 other doors open up. And you're like, okay, let's do this.